We sort of, Tibet Sok came up to us and asked if they could do some sort of poetry slam. Poetry slam's what we normally do, but it wouldn't have really worked like this, so we ended up with this open mic where we got each of the different societies representing a different sort of oppressed country, or, you know, and it turned out incredibly. It was really good. But we also just a little plug that I'll do right now is we do stuff like this off on next Thursday. We have a workshop to teach people how to do slams, so, you know, you get taught, I don't know, presentation, things like that. I've not been to one of them, so I don't know what you get taught. You get taught about poetry, he probably knows. And then on the 21st, we've got a pub quiz here, where a literature pub quiz. And then on the 28th, we have another poetry slam, and so on and so forth. So, you know, look us up on the internet. I thought I'd read a poem, as it's not a slam, so you can read poems that aren't yours, about a piece of colonialism a bit closer to home. It's one of my favourite poems, and it's Easter 1916 by Yeats. It's about, anyone there? Yeah. And, you know, I mean, yeah, there was a war of independence that happened 3 years after this poem, which 2,000 people died in. And then, you know, in Ireland from 1960 to 1998, 3,500 people died there, most of them Irish. So, you know, that's a kind of a shameful and little recognised part of British history, I guess. I have met them at the close of day, coming with vivid faces, from counter or desk among grey 18th century houses. I have passed with a nod of the head or polite meaningless words, or have lingered a while and said polite meaningless words. I have thought before I'd done of a mocking tale or jibe to please a companion around the fire at the club, being certain that they and I but lived where motley is worn. All changed, changed utterly, a terrible beauty is born. That woman's days were spent in ignorant goodwill, her nights in argument until her voice grew shrill. What voice more sweet than hers when young and beautiful she rode to Herriers? The man had kept a school and rode a winged horse. This other, his helper and friend, was coming into his force. He might have won fame in the end, so sensitive his nature seemed, so daring and sweet his thought. This other man, I had dreamed a drunken, vainglorious lout. He had done most bitter wrong to someone who near my heart. Yet I number him in this song. He too has resigned his part in the casual comedy. He too has changed his turn, transformed utterly. A terrible beauty is born. Hearts with one purpose alone through summer and winter seem enchanted to a stone. To trouble the living stream, the horse that comes down the road, the rider, the birds that range from cloud to tumbling cloud. Minute by minute they change, a shadow of a cloud on the stream changes minute by minute. A horse hoof slides on the brim, and a horse plashes within it. The long-legged moorhens dive, and hens to moorcocks call. Minute by minute live, the stones in midst of all. Too long a sacrifice can make a stone of the heart. Oh, when may it suffice? That is heaven's part, our part, to murmur name upon name, as a mother names her child when sleep at last has come. On limbs that had run wild. What is that but nightfall? No, no, not night, but death. Was it needless death after all? For England may keep faith for all that is done and said. We know their dream enough to know that they dreamed and are dead. And what if excess of love bewildered them till they died? I write it out in a verse. MacDonald and McBride and Connolly and Percy. Now, and in time to be, wherever green is worn, a changed, changed utterly, a terrible beauty is born. Summer is off to events, and thank you.